And so with no stopping now, let's get started. So I want to welcome William here. William's an ABC election analyst. I'm going to read this from my script. Crikey commentator and author of Australia's longest running political blog, Poll Bludger. And William's going to give a presentation on the key voting patterns. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Now, I hope that Karen and I, between us, will offer a nice rounded perspective on this, because Karen, I assume, will be looking at survey data and probing into the mind of the voter. And that's what I might call the micro approach to election analysis. I'll be taking the macro approach, where I'll be looking at how all the votes added together and what it looks like on the electoral map. So it will be very geographically driven, because that's all I've got to work with, quite frankly. So, as we are aware, there was an election about 3 or so weeks ago and it went rather well for Labor. I have two graphs here broadly illustrating that point in historical context. Now, was anyone fortunate enough to be at Anthony Green's presentation at the Constitutional Centre the day before the election? A couple of you? Well, you were very privileged, because he hit the nail right on the head and the result vindicated what he was saying very well indeed, which was that this was the election where one vote, one value brought home the bacon for Labor. You might have thought it was introduced at the 2008 election. Labor then had two bad results in a row, and for a while you might there have thought that one vote, one value hadn't done any Labor any favours. But now we've learned that it has really risen the ceiling on what Labor can achieve electorally, which is sort of the point that I'm trying to illustrate with these two graphs. What we have here, both of them illustrate election results going back to 1974, which happened to be when Charles Court brought the Liberal Party to power. The bottom one is two-party preferred vote. That's a slightly slippery concept. Some of it's estimated, but you get the idea. This election was just that little bit better for Labor in two-party terms than Brian Burke's two victories in 1983 and 1986, which were previously Labor's two high watermarks going back to the post-war era. All three were better than either of the victories that Jeff Gallop had. So, but it didn't blow the roof off what Brian Burke achieved. If we've got the numbers there, Brian Burke got 53.7 and 54.1. This is 55.5. That's an estimate. It might be a bit lower, it might be a bit higher, but it's a little bit better. Translate that into seats, though, and it's a much better result than Labor have ever had in Western Australian history. 41 seats. The size of the chamber has increased a little bit over this time, 55 to 59. Nothing too dramatic. It's a more or less level playing field for looking at how Labor's seats have evolved over the years. And before this election, it looked like Labor had a ceiling of 32 seats. That's all they ever got under Brian Burke. It's the best they did. I think both Jeff Gallop's elections were 32 seats. And now they've completely blown the lid off that and gotten all the way to 41. So what that teaches us is that when Labor has a little bit more wind in its sails these days, it can really bring home a bag full of metropolitan seats. There are many more of those seats now than there were before 2008. So in a broader sense, this is, you know, as good of a win for Labor has ever had in vote terms, but quite a bit better than they've ever had before in seat terms. Now, I now intend to show how to better illustrate that point, I think. Let's see how the electoral map has progressed over the last four elections. What we have here is the electoral map at the 2005 election, the last time Labor won an election before this one, when Jeff Gallop was re-elected. However, they are not the 2005 boundaries. These are the 2005 election results transposed on to the 2008 boundaries when one vote, one value was introduced. So this is what the 2005 election result would have looked if it had been held under one vote, one value, and there had been 42 electorates in the metropolitan area rather than 34 as had previously been the case. So that's the map Labor thought they were buying when they brought in one vote, one value. Of course, things did not go according to plan, and what happened instead was this. That was the result of the 2008 election. Now, the really big electorates happened to go from Labor to Liberal, so maybe that makes the transition look more exciting than it actually is. But nonetheless, clearly this is a bluer map than 2005 and an illustration of the rather bad show that Labor had at that election. It wasn't a historically disastrous performance. In two-party terms, it was quite a mild defeat. The Liberals and the Nationals between them didn't get a majority, so it was a pretty middling kind of election, but it was quite a bit less good than Labor had anticipated at the time. And as a result, no one was talking much about one vote, one value after that election, and certainly not after the next election when things went to bad for worse from Labor's perspective. So, God, you know, John Quigley hangs on to Butler, which is a nice big electorate, which adds a lot of red to the map, but if you kind of, you could squeeze this around so that each electorate had the same amount of geographical size, you would see that as bad as 2008 was, 2013 was quite a lot worse, and Labor were losing seats that they never lose. Perth, they haven't lost since the 60s, I don't think. And Forestfield, we all know the dismal story, and you probably don't want to hear it again, given that you have this nice, happy state of affairs to refer to now. Where are you? Is this you? And that's what we look like again now. That's what the previous election map looks like when you tack a 13% swing onto it. And under the single member constituency system, you really have, I'm losing my faith in the single member constituency system. I'm becoming a bit of a proportional representation advocate, because you get these wipeout election results like the one in Queensland in 2012, where there was nothing left of the Labor Party. A third of the public voted for them. They had seven members. And, obviously, probably we're happier about it now in this room, given that we're the beneficiaries of it. We, you. But at the moment, you know, I think that maybe democracy would be better served if there was a little bit more blue in the chamber, given that over 30% of the people did in fact vote for them. Now, let's compare that result, the 2016-17 result, with the 2005 result. Have I done that properly? Yes, I have. It's not that different. The only seat that's different is Kalamunda. The only seat Labor won at this election that they wouldn't have won based on the 2005 results was Kalamunda. For all that this was a much better election, we're talking 55.5% two-party preferred Labor versus 52.5%. That 3% extra bonus on top of the 2005 result only brings home that one seat. So when you look at it that way, this is less a revolutionary result than it looked on election night. It is more, it's a classic good, great result for Labor under the new system. And, I suspect that in years to come, the next time two changes of government from now and Labor are next winning a landslide, when they'll be replicating this sort of performance. Now, what's interesting comparing this election with the last election is that we can observe the irreducible cause of both the Liberal Party and the Labor Party. This is presumably about as bad as it's ever going to get for the Liberal Party. So which seats are the Liberals never going to lose? They are never going to lose the Western suburbs. They are never going to lose those Canning Riverfront suburbs. I wouldn't go quite that far. You know, things can always get worse for them. They could lose Riverton if things get worse. But broadly speaking, we all know where the Liberal Party heartland is. What I think is interesting about it, though, is that I refer to the Western suburbs. The Western suburbs are expanding. Obviously, that only makes them Western to a certain amount, but as an electoral fact, over the years, what's happened is that the real estate between the city and the ocean is the most desirable real estate in Perth. Go back 30, 40 years, that's quite a limited area. It is strictly the Western suburbs. But as the sprawl moves north, the safe Liberal area along the coast expands. What you generally have at the fringe of the metropolitan area is an extremely electorally volatile area. That's where young families move. Young families are not caked on in their in their political loyalty, and when there is a swing on, they move en masse. So it's traditionally been the case that when there has been a change of government, what has happened, particularly at the northern end of the suburban sprawl, all of those seats change hands en masse. As well as that, at the very edge of the metropolitan area, particularly now at the northern end, things get better for Labor. Butler, partly, probably, I think John Quigley is a very effective local member, and there is a bit of a personal vote for him there. But it's also the case that if you are a person of modest means and you want to live near the beach, that's the only place for you to go, so it ends up being quite good for Labor. And a difficult nut to crack for the Liberals. They did not win Butler in 2008 or in 2013. So we're getting demographically more like the eastern suburbs than the north. Now, I think a point I wanted to move on to now is what perhaps this means for the federal sphere. And I, just out of amusement, I thought I would, obviously my sense of amusement is not that of a normal person. But this is what the federal election would have looked like on state boundaries. I got that right? Yeah, that's what that is. I've got so many maps here, I'm losing track of them all. But yes, that's what that is, and it's not massively different from the 2013. So while in many respects the last year's federal election result was reasonably encouraging for Labor in Western Australia, they picked up a couple of seats, they picked up a swing, they've got a very long way to go. It was still a 55-56% two-party preferred result, only a little bit better than the 2013 election. I've actually got Labor losing Girraween on this, which surprises me, because Girraween is in Cowan and Labor won Cowan. So Labor is still underperforming at federal level. I think other things being equal, Labor will always do better at state and federal level in Western Australia. There's a kind of anti-Canberra sentiment in Western Australia that the Liberals harness. So I think that the ceiling for Labor is lower at federal level than it is at state. But, yeah, as I said, that doesn't work into my narrative anymore. I just put the work into doing it, and I thought you might like to see it. What might be of greater interest, in fact I'm fairly certain it will be, is what the result of the state election would look like if you transpose it onto federal boundaries. Which is a little bit something like this, and which is some pretty big Liberal scalps on that platter, chiefly among which is that of Christian Porter in Pearce, who loses by 12%. Pearce becomes Labor's fifth safest electorate in Western Australia. And it outperforms Stirling, it outperforms Hasluck. And this is what's, I think, interesting to me about this creeping western suburban sprawl, is that the marginal zone is being pushed further north, and that area I intimated towards where at the very northern end of the coastal corridor, you're sort of too far away from the city for it to be desirable from a real estate perspective. So we're talking about battlers here, we're talking about Labor voters. Increasingly that's being pushed into the electorate of Pearce. With each new electoral redistribution, Pearce is absorbing more of the urban fringes. It used to be more of a rural electorate, or semi-rural at least. And Moore, which is one of the few remaining blue seats there, has it is now an established suburban electorate. It's not growing. They don't contract it with each redistribution. It's now a settled, established area, and so safe for the Liberal Party that even in the context of a theoretical bloodbath like this one, they still hold on to more by 2%. The other interesting thing that I, from my perspective about this, is that Pearce is now a more viable electorate for Labor than Stirling. Now, I understand we have a former member for Stirling here who can tell us all about this. Once upon a time, Labor used to win Stirling in a good year. But that's an extremely difficult nut for Labor to crack now. The margin federally in Pearce is now lower. It's 3-4%, Stirling 5-6% after the last election. And while I have Labor winning Stirling on this map, they are doing so by a relatively modest margin. So, and perhaps also Hasluck, Hasluck still, I think, you know, a real line ball seat. But it will be a really grim result for the Liberals if ever they lose Stirling. I think Pearce is quite a lot more winnable than Stirling is now. Is there anything else interesting about that picture? No, other than that, you know, the marginal seats, Labor are winning them, and the Labor seats, obviously, they're winning those. So, just to drill down a little bit deeper here, instead of just making it the electorate level, this looks at the result at the polling booth level. So I've painstakingly applied geographic catchment areas to each polling booth, and this is what the result looked like in 2013. This is what the result looked like a couple of weeks ago. So to talk about just, I'm probably sorry if I'm overprivileging the northern suburbs here, but what has occurred to me to discuss. Here's that expanding northward western suburban Liberal area in action. What we see is that once you get past Hillary's, it loses its depth. It's still there, even in the context of this terrible election, the Liberals were still winning the booths along the ocean up around Ocean Reef Way. But go a little bit further inland and now you've got a red area around Joondalup. Further south, the blue area extends all the way into the freeway. So as a result, the electorates immediately west of the city, Churchlands, Nedlands, Cottesloe, Scarborough, Corrine, they are reliably blue electorates now. Once upon a time, Scarborough was a marginal seat, not anymore. But when you get to the north, you've got a dynamic going on where you've got Liberal voting coastal suburbs, but Labor voting suburbs further inland, and there is a nice tension between the two, and you end up with marginal seats, namely Burns Beach and Joondalup, which Labor brought in this time. And so clearly, coastal living, obviously, it's a desirable thing, and it's attracting people on higher incomes, and that phenomenon is moving further and further to the north. How much time do I have?
You have 7 minutes.
Okay, I dispatched with that more efficiently than I'd anticipated, so I am... But all is not lost. I thought if I have time, I will discuss the Upper House and prospects for Upper House electoral reform. Now, as brilliant as this result was for Labor, they are going to be butting their heads against a, I hesitate to say hostile Upper House, but certainly not a friendly one. So if I've done this correctly, all right, here's the results. I should have prettied this up, but I've got the actual results on the left. So leave 4x9 model aside for the time being. Between them, the Labor and the Greens parties have 18 seats out of 36. I don't know how they're going in trying to lure Simon O'Brien into accepting the presidency of the Legislative Council. If he continues to do what he says he's going to do, which is the right thing by the Liberal Party, the position will end up having to go to a Labor member, and the Labor and the Greens between them will only have 17 votes on the floor, and on the floor they will be outvoted by the 18 votes of what can collectively be called right of centre parties, to which the Liberals, the Nationals, One Nation, Shooters and Fishers, and the Liberal Democrat Party, assuming that Aaron Stonehouse is like you'd imagine a Liberal Democrat to be, but that's anyone's guess at this stage. So, obviously, Labor quite reasonably are crying foul that they have had this massive landslide victory and yet their legislative program is imperiled by the potential hostility of the upper chamber. So we're going to be hearing a lot more over the next few years about how the situation might be reformed. Probably it ought to have happened when One Vote, One Value was brought in 2008, but the politics surrounding that were extremely complex and we were left with a Legislative Council that continued to divide the seats evenly between metropolitan and non-metropolitan areas. The mathematics of this are nice and easy to digest. 3/4 of the Western Australian population lives in the metropolitan area. But instead of having a 75-25 split of upper house representation, we have a 50-50 split. We have 3 non-metropolitan regions, 3 metropolitan regions. Each of them have 6 members. So we have 36 members, half of them a country, half of them a city. Under a one vote, one value regime, it would be 3/4 versus 1/4. So it has been proposed to me, and this is the beautifully elegant way of fixing this, is to what I call the 4x9 model. You take the 3 non-metropolitan regions, agricultural, mining and pastoral and southwest, you bung them together into one non-metropolitan region, so now we've got 4 regions instead of 6, and we have a beautifully replicated reflection of the Western Australian population, where 3/4 of the regions are metropolitan regions and 1/4 of them is non-metropolitan. We want to keep the House at 36 seats, though, for various reasons. Therefore, instead of having 6 members per region, we have 9 members per region. We stay with 36 seats, and all of the kind of ugly constitutional things you have to do to get a major change can be avoided. So how would that look at an election? Well, I ran this through my whatever you call it, my stats program, to calculate how the results of the election would have played out with the same preference tickets if this situation had been in place. Now, one of the things that comes through here is the capriciousness of our electoral system. For example, South Metropolitan, I have got Daylight Saving Party winning a seat, the seat that was instead won by the Liberal Democrats. Now, you might think that if the Liberal Democrats can win a seat in a 6-member region, if you increase that to 9 members, surely they're going to win a seat. No. They got a seat because they were purely lucky because of the way that quotas were divided up and the amount of preferences that flowed this way and that way, and it ends up being completely arbitrary. Make a little change to the system and you get a very different result. So as it happened, the Liberal Democrats were lucky to edge out the Daylight Saving Party for that seat. But under my prognostication, if you make that a 9-member model, then it is the Daylight Saving Party that win instead. The Greens win a seat. The Greens win a seat in each of the. As I've calculated it, the Greens win a seat in each of my four regions. However, I've got asterisks next to a couple of them in the regional area because it was pretty much touch and go. The Shooters and Fishers Party miss out. Again, you know, you'd think the Shooters and Fishers Party might go to town if you have a 9-member region for the non-metropolitan area. But no, according to my calculations, the Shooters and Fishers lose out. And however, only just. The reason these asterisks are here is that it's really touch and go between the Nationals, the Greens and the Shooters and Fishers to win two of the last three contestants for the last two seats, and it ends up being very close. What you end up with is not actually that dramatically different a result. There'll be a lot of crying foul about how Labor are acting in their own interest. No doubt they are, but they're right to be doing so because, you know, they have been stiffed here. But it is not a revolutionary change. Labor only win one extra seat. As a matter of fact, the Liberals win one extra as well. The real losers, obviously, are the National Party. They're down to two. The Greens are pretty much tread water and hold even. One Nation do get two seats. They were lucky to win a third as it was, so probably status quo-ish for them. Shooters may or may not have won. And we end up with a different mix of micro-party oddbods on the crossbench. Interestingly, we have the Australian Christians and Family First each winning a seat. I think this is a real significant difference of having 9-member regions rather than 6-member ones. That Christian block, you know, you have the Australian Christians, you have Family First, you might have a couple of other, you know, sort of right-wing Christian parties in the mix. Yep, fabulous. They preference each other and they don't quite have enough votes to get anywhere under the existing system. Neither Australian Christians or Family First have ever won a seat in Western Australia. They never quite get there. Increase it to 9 members, though, and suddenly they're a show. So when you hear talk about presuming that they're going to proceed along the lines of this model, about what a wonderful thing it is going to be for progressive politics, maybe that's true in a lot of ways, but it will also open the door, I think, to a sort of that kind of Christian political sentiment, which for one reason or another has been locked out in Western Australia, and I think that brings me to the end.
Great, thank you. We're going to now, I'm very happy to introduce Karen Luscombe, who's the principal researcher for the WA Opinion Polls, and they conduct the focus groups and surveys on the WA politics, and she's been doing that for 25 odd years, and that includes the polls and the work that we did at Unions WA leading up to this election. So it's really great to have Karen back here again. I'm really interested in what you got to say. I enjoyed what you said last year about the average Joe Blow voter. So you might hear yourself in the stats. So thank you.
Right. Amazing. Thank you very, very much. We are social researchers. Jim's over there, and when we're answering questions, some of them I'm sure Jim will be able to answer better than I. So we do conduct social research with our intrepid team of interviewers who conduct telephone interviews and so forth. And we talk to people in quite a lot of detail. To understand what people think about particular issues and to help organisations to correct errors of perception, increase people's knowledge about important issues and move attitudes. So it's quite different from the public polls that we often hear William talking about in the media, where people are sort of polling votes mostly to sell newspapers and so forth at the time. So there's a big distinction there. It was a very big election win, there's no doubt about that, but there was nothing easy or inevitable about it. The foundations for this election victory were laid at the last election, and the last election in 2013, as we saw very well from the from the maps that William put up, was extremely difficult for Labor at the time. But the concerns that were moving votes towards Labor at that time were that Mr Barnett was seen as arrogant and out of touch with people's needs, and you could remember that they, in that first term of government, they hiked up electricity charges very early, and then there were a lot of things that were said which showed that there was no understanding of how that impacted on people, and infamously you might remember the comments about air conditioning, that people don't need air conditioning in Perth, and people felt that Mr Barnett didn't have a very good understanding of what it's like to live in the eastern suburbs. And people have elderly parents and so forth who were not running heaters in winter and turning off their air conditioners if they had them in summer because of their financial budgets and difficulties that they were facing. So that was seen as very arrogant and out of touch, and there were many, many other things that one can point to in that vein. Also that the government had the wrong priorities, spending on things like Elizabeth Quay instead of health and education and other services that people see as important. And privatisation of services, particularly health services, so forth at that time. That election also established Mark McGowan as a younger, family-oriented person who represents an electorate much more in touch with ordinary people, being Rockingham. But the environment was extremely toxic for Labor at that time, coming from the Rudd-Gillard government federally, and it was extremely difficult to have any sort of real debates on issues that were important to people or for messages to come through in the media. And the conversations which we had around that time, following that election, were how important it was going to be to develop the themes and narratives needed to connect with people over the 4 years in between. Now, look, very happily, I can say that what happened was that those themes and narratives were carried on extremely well based on those foundations that were built in that election campaign. And the ones that the Liberals developed were terrible, actually, over the period. And we can see some of the mistakes that they made. So we can see that the sort of things that happened in 2013 and 14 after that election were that promises were broken very, very quickly, with, you know, spectacular speed after the 2013 election, such that it did lead people, you know, soft voters, to say that they must have known before the election that they were not going to deliver on these things, that things were said to win votes, to counteract Labor's policies on things like public transport. And it did bring a real flavour of dishonesty to people's views of Mr Barnett. People felt, you know, that there had been lies and that they had been deliberately misled. And that was, it was a major mistake. It was a repeat of the mistake they made, in a way, in their first term, which was to think that you could bring out all this bad news really quickly, straight after the election, people get over it. You know, that is just an attitude which is somewhat arrogant and which does, you know, people were interpreting in 2013 as being taken for fools. We then had cuts to services through 2013 and some very spectacular cuts in education late in 2013, which people felt very, very strongly about. And if you remember those, they included cuts to teachers but also cuts to education assistants. And we had people in various focus groups, people in different segments in the community who've never really engaged with education in this way, such as men in blue-collar occupations who tend to leave all that sort of stuff to other people to think about, getting very angry about that because they could see very clearly what the impact of that would be. That, you know, this is something that people have had experience with. Their children go to school, they know what classrooms are like, they know that the education assistants are incredibly important in terms of leveraging teachers' time. They know that they're very inexpensive, so that it was an inefficient way to cut costs. You know, you're not going to rescue the budget by cutting out people who earn less than $40,000, is what people were saying. And they knew that individual attention in classrooms would fall because teachers need the assistance to deal with the special needs children, and they also need to use their education assistance to run literacy and numeracy programs and all those sorts of things that people regard as very important. And you didn't need any special knowledge about the topic to understand that. Anybody who's got children in schools, you know, could tell us colourful stories about what goes on in classrooms and how that was important. So then we also had the federal budget in 2014 and the state budget in 2014. Now, people, of course, remember that federal budget, and it again really damaged the Bulls brand in terms of what they are doing for health and education. In that budget, we had discussion about university fees, and we also had the state budget, which they sort of tried to hide a couple of weeks later after the federal budget. But in that budget, there were cuts to concessions for older people, which was something that over a period of time really undermined their constituency with older electors, which is something that they've come to rely on over many years. So through this whole period, older people were also feeling all the financial pressures, which we know are there now, and they're also seeing their concessions and assistance reduced. We also had the loss of the AAA rating in August 2014, and that started to bring in a very clear report card on the state government's financial management. People felt that they'd been spending on the wrong things, not focusing their attention on important services like health and education, spending too much on projects that some people describe as vanity projects like Elizabeth Key and a whole range of others. But really, the conversation there was that people do like to see public infrastructure built. They do want to see planning for the long term and things built that are going to meet the needs of the future. However, what they want is that spend to be extremely effectively targeted to things that are important for the whole community and will underpin the economy going forward as well. Things like public transport, hospitals which have sufficient capacity, and that, you know, that was a criticism around the planning of the children's hospital over an extended period of time, all those sorts of things. So it's not as if people were really saying they shouldn't be spending anything on new infrastructure. It was that the choices appeared to be wrong, the priorities were wrong, and towards the end of the election cycle, much more, you know, people were saying these were recreational things for tourists rather than the important things that people need. We had the opening of Fiona Stanley Hospital in late 2014 as well, and there was so much news surrounding that, which revolved around problems associated with contracts, privatisation of services, the sterilisation issues, the IT issues, but the cost blowouts. For a period of time, they were paying Serco for a hospital with no patients, you know, which is the classic, you know, yes minister sort of plot. People could see very clearly that these were examples of mismanagement as far as they were concerned in this important area. They were very pleased to have an exciting new hospital. However, there were all these important facets that were going wrong with it. And we found that people were extremely anxious about a constellation of issues at the end of 2014. So there were lots of very, very detailed conversations with people in different segments. The community, I mean, it is always important to understand that the community is, of course, made up of young people and people with families and people who are in that middle segment of the community who may have young families, elderly parents, jobs, saving for their superannuation, having to deal with all of the problems of their own financial management, plus having concerns about the state's financial management because it affects their employment and things like that, particularly if they work in health or education, or if they work in the public sector, or if they're being influenced by the policies of the government. And then they also have, as I said, elderly parents. They're concerned about aged care. We have the older groups who have got concerns. Self-funded retirees have seen their incomes slashed over the last few years, and they have a lot of problems dealing with their own budgets and accessing the services that they need, as well as pensioners. And we've also got fly-in, fly-out households and a whole range of different groups with different needs that we were talking to at that time. Now, what we found was that the level of anxiety across all of those groups was actually very, very high. Over the years, we haven't seen the sort of anxiety that we were seeing in high income, you know, among high income, professional, managerial sort of people that we were starting to see at that point. In all groups, people were talking about jobs and job security, how incomes were being cut, how the mining industry was clearly laying off people, but also other businesses were laying a lot of people off as well, cutting back, small business people taking home more money, less money, and people were feeling a lot of job insecurity. At that time, I think it'd be true to say that the way people regard job security at the current, in the current era, is their chances of getting another one as much as anything. People find that they're in jobs for a much shorter period of time than used to be the case decades ago, and so people have get their sense of job security from their own perception of how easy it'll be for them to get another one. Often they're on short-term contracts, how easy it's going to be to get another contract, and all of those things were becoming extremely insecure at that point. Unemployment is an issue which is very different from how it looked 20 years ago, where we had high levels of unemployment, say, in the early 90s, which were, you know, a real issue for the community. Now, unemployment is something that is spread right across the community because it means a lot of people are getting less hours, a lot of people have got greater job insecurity. Underemployment is, you know, terribly poorly reported in all the figures that we have to hand. We also had a high cost of living that people were feeling very strongly at that time. This is a couple of years ago now. Yep. They felt that costs had risen significantly during the boom and remained high in Western Australia, even though things have gone backwards, and that's still largely very true. Certainly very high housing costs, and housing being unaffordable for many, and therefore you've got the people in that sandwich generation with their young people still living at home because they can't afford houses. You've got people very anxious about their children in terms of whether they're going to get jobs, whether they're going to be able to afford housing, whether they're going to be able to afford to have families. As a result of the education cuts in this state and the federal budget, we had a very strong perception that educational opportunities were moving out of reach for people, that university could become unaffordable if the federal government implemented the deregulation of fees that they were talking about, and we also had people responding very strongly to the hikes in TAFE fees, and lots of segments of the community saying that even TAFE was becoming out of reach for them at times when they really needed it, because TAFE training's required for jobs that don't pay very much. Very low hourly rates come from a lot of the things that people are going to do with their TAFE qualifications. And people could also see that services were going backwards and that there were areas of unmet need. So the cuts in education, again, health services, mental health, policing becoming less responsive and less visible in the community, a whole range of things that we could talk about. I mean, there's stories behind all of this, obviously. So this understanding was very important for framing the messages and the policies which came forward into this election period. And I don't have a lot of slides about the coming period. I just will leave that one there for the moment and talk about what happened. So in 2016, the state budget was a situation where we had a very big deficit forecast, a very large state debt, and very large state debt projected going forward. So this shock deficit prediction was used as a justification for asset sales and further cuts to services, basically. And that was a terrible narrative and hard to believe that anyone thought it was going to be a good idea to say that at the time. In people's minds, it translated to the fact that important assets will have to be sold because of poor financial management. And, you know, there's no one else to look at except for the government. I mean, so basically in people's minds, important assets would have to be sold because of the government's poor financial management, which they saw as having been a major issue in the last few years and continuing issue. Labor began to talk about a plan for jobs, and after the federal election and the Olympics, we had the businessman's poll, which occupied an entire month of media and led to the leadership challenge in the Liberal Party. Now, at that time, if you probably recall that poll, it did predict that the Liberals would lose a lot of seats and that there were big swings on. And, I mean, that there were big swings on was entirely accurate. However, the analysis of that poll, based on our experience and our data, was misleading in the newspaper. And if you read the fine print in that particular story, it said the two-party preferred figures had been generated by the West Australian rather than Reachtel, who had produced the first preference votes. And on our analysis of those figures, on sort of how the undecided people were moving and also how preferences were flowing at that time, Labor was winning at that time significantly fewer seats than how that was presented in the media. So I guess the point about that was that at that time, the swings in the marginal seats ranged from about 7% in some seats to 12 or more percent in other outer metropolitan seats, particularly in the southern suburbs of the city. But it was by no means the situation that Labor was a shoo-in to win the election at that point. People in the outer suburbs were feeling the economic pressures very, very strongly. They were badly affected by problems with jobs, and they needed services. There are a lot of schools are very overcrowded in some of those areas, and they strongly felt that the infrastructure spends that had been made did not benefit them. The problem for Labor, of course, was that the swings were uneven, and the task was to win a lot of seats with very large swings needed in those last few seats, and with individual seats with special issues which could make those swings difficult to obtain in individual seats. And it does come down at the end of the day, as successful members in this room know, to winning seat by seat. And there are lots of accidents that can happen, lots of things that can go wrong, and lots of local factors that can be important. So that was the story at that time, and a very positive campaign was needed, and it was necessary to fight very hard in all of those seats for people to actually win them. The problem for the Liberals, with their Liberal leadership turmoil and the turmoil with the coalition, it undermined the view of strong and solid Colin that had been the sort of one of the last things they had to hang on to. People started to say, well, if even their own side are saying he's not any good, then that was reinforcing the doubts that people had, and that some groups who still had faith in Colin Barnett were beginning to have that faith shaken at that time. We also had continuing financial problems for the state and bad figures. We also had bad economic news, where the situation in Western Australia was described as being worse than, you know, the Tasmania. And that, for some reason, seemed to really resonate with people. There's growing frustration with the government over jobs, and we saw that swings in most seats had moved out another 2% by the end of 2016. And we were starting to see people say that it's clear that the government has no plan for jobs, and they have sent the state broke. So there was the sort of opportunity for the Liberals to rewrite that story, or to show they had plans, or to demonstrate they were going to be able to do something about those issues, was rapidly disappearing. People who had kept an open mind about it, people who'd been unsure, people who'd been dissatisfied with them, but who were not sure who to vote for and were still holding open the possibility of voting Liberal, began to conclude that they haven't done enough to rejuvenate the economy, they haven't done enough to diversify the economy. In fact, diversification has gone backwards during the boom, and they have failed even with their own spend on contracts to support sufficient local content and sufficient local jobs. And the financial management problem was of such magnitude that people were beginning to firm up their votes at that point. Good. So, however, it still would have been possible to record big swings that were not quite enough, especially if the Liberals had run a good campaign. And at the end of 2016, there were popular Liberal members who were holding back the swings in their seats. People had worked very hard in their own seats, built relationships with community groups, spent a lot of time talking to their electors. That was the case in some seats, most notably places like Joondalup. It was also a bit of an issue in Mount Lawley, much less so in a seat like Morley. There were a range there. But it was clear that those seats were not in the bag at that stage. So Labor began their public campaign early in January, and that was important to show people that they had the energy and ideas and were prepared to talk about the issues and plans. Mr Barnett's response was to be prickly and negative, which reinforced views that people already had about him. Anyone who wants to be elected for 4 years needs to show they've got some plans and some energy and some enthusiasm and project that energy and ideas. And in January, there were more problems with the Children's Hospital that reinforced the things that people see is wrong with privatisation in terms of the quality control and too much overseas involvement. Later, we had the footbridge, which also reinforced that issue, and people felt that their tax dollars were going to pay for their own jobs to be sent overseas, which is, you know, a very negative thing for a community. The media was starting to focus more on other issues towards in the first week of the campaign, because it was a campaign that could become boring due to the fact that people couldn't make big promises with the straitened financial times. Then we had the One Nation deal, which of course was a great gift for the media and very difficult for the Liberal Party to deal with at that time. It was seen as an unprincipled act of self-interest, basically, and also an extraordinary disunity with the National Party. So it did galvanise votes among people away from the Liberal Party, and over a period of weeks that story unfolded. There was more movement among soft Liberals and undecided people away from the government. It was one of a constellation of issues that had that effect, and look, it was always going to be very rich fodder for the media, so you know, I can't see how that was unexpected either. Throughout the campaign, the Liberals did fail to get a message out. The issues that were moving votes during the campaign, broken too many promises, particularly in public transport, that affected some seats more than others, spent money on the wrong things, not looked at the important issues that affect people. They needed to improve the job situation. There was a big response on opposition to sale of Western Power based on all of the negative things that people have seen through privatisation in the hospitals. And there was also the deal with One Nation, opposition to Row 8, penalty rates, and people were affected by job losses in services. A couple of points that I'd just like to make. The thing with privatisation with Western Power is a story that ran over many years. It all fitted together, and we can talk in the questions about the things that people feel about privatisation. But people do have a very detailed view of the concerns that they have with privatisation, but they are prepared to look at it on a case-by-case basis. People believe that important public services should be publicly run, that innovation and improvement and getting the best results for the community should be possible, but that now creates a very real challenge, now that the government has changed, to make that the case, to bring that about, and to be able to improve the services in very straitened financial times, and to reorganise things where necessary to get better results for people. I mean, that's what the community is looking for. Why did the swing go so far? Very targeted messages, talking about the things that people thought were important, very layered communication coming through lots of avenues, very genuine efforts to engage people, which I'm sure a lot of people that were in this room were involved with. And also there was a patchwork of many issues. Apart from the main issues, there were lots of other issues which were important to individual people, including, you know, penalty rates, Row 8, even things like puppy farms and animal welfare. So there were many, many, many things that that came together in this result, and it was an example of many facets of the progressive community pulling together. And it was about the central, you know, the central elements were about a sustained narrative over a long period of time, about talking to people about the things that were really important to them some years ago, understanding those, and building all of that understanding into connecting with people and bringing forward policies. Obviously, the challenges that now face this government are very great.